subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Terrorists infiltrating into India through tunnels constructed by Pakistani rangers. Pakistan committing genocide in Indian subcontinent since decades. And Pak Anti-Terrorism Court jails three close aides of Hafiz Saeed in terror financing case. Peace in Jammu and Kashmir territory remains volatile due to consistent Pakistan-aided terror activities in the region. For this purpose, infiltration is a major technique being used to sustain terrorism in the valley. Pakistan Army is not only using cross-border firing as a tool to facilitate infiltration, but is also using tunnels to support terrorists to sneak into Indian territories. A trans-border tunnel along the international frontier with Pakistan was detected recently in Jammu and Kashmir, which clearly signals towards active infiltration attempts by Pakistan-based terrorists at the border. A report.
Another Pakistani lie busted. More evidence unearthed revealing Pakistan's complicity in pushing terrorists into India. Indian security forces discovered one more secret tunnel along the international border in Jammu and Kashmir's Kathua district, which traces its way back to Pakistan, a country whose single point agenda is to disrupt peace and accord in India. Several sandbags recovered from the tunnel have Pakistani markings with the manufacturing dates of 2016-2017, which suggest that it is an old tunnel used by Pakistani intelligence to infiltrate terrorists into India. The tunnel is around 150 meters long and 30 feet deep and has a diameter much bigger than 3 feet so that a man can easily cross by crawling. On the other side of the fence are Pakistani border outposts in Shakargarh district, which is home to a terror training facility overseen by Pak-backed Jaish-e-Mohammed. It is the same area where BSF had shot down a Pakistani hexacopter carrying load of arms and ammunition in June 2020 and foiled an infiltration bid in November 2019.
It is similar to the tunnels which have been detected earlier also, similar in the design, similar in the making, and similar kind of an engineering effort has gone into making this tunnel. The Pakistani BOPs in this AOR are Abyar Dogra and Kingre de Kote. There is a famous terrorist launch pad in this area by the name Masroor Badabhai, and it falls in Shakargarh district. Shakargarh district is notorious for having a couple of launch pads here, about 4 to 5, which extend in our Samba and Kathua districts. So as a result of our anti-tunnel campaign, this is the fourth tunnel which we have detected in the last 6 months and 10th or 11th in the last 6 to 7 years.
Failing to push in terrorists into Indian side from the traditional method of cross-border firing, Pakistan has now resorted to underground means of pushing in ultras. It is the second tunnel to be spotted by the Indian security forces in the past 10 days that last year went on campaign mode to detect and destroy a web of tunnels built by Pakistan's deep state. Earlier on January 13, security forces detected a tunnel opening 20 to 30 meters behind the barbed wire fence in the same district. Last year too, two such tunnels were detected in Samba district of the Union Territory following successful infiltration by Pakistani terrorists affiliated with Jaish-e-Mohammed, armed with weapons and a large quantity of grenades. However, they were later neutralized in separate encounters along Jammu-Srinagar National Highway while they were en route to Kashmir in trucks.
You see, when we talk of intrusion, there are four levels at which intrusion can take place within India. First is air, second is ground, third is sea, and fourth is underground. Pakistan has exhausted its strength or capability to intrude terrorists using the air level or air model. Ground, it is not successful because of implementation of very good implementation of CIBMS, Comprehensive Integrated Border Management System, which is the gift of Modi government to armed forces. Intrusion has become very difficult within JNK. So what sea is also difficult. So Pakistan is resorting to underground model. And the underground model, the model is that you prepare tunnel and try to infiltrate your terrorists within India.
For constructing trans-border tunnels to create new infiltration routes, Pakistan is even using ceasefire violations to draw the attention of security forces from spots where they are building tunnels. According to statistics compiled by the Jammu and Kashmir Police, there were 930 instances of ceasefire violations in 2020, a 54% increase over the 605 instances in 2019. With Pakistan's propaganda machinery falling flat after the abrogation of Article 370 last year, it is making every attempt to send terrorists to the Kashmir Valley to unleash chaos and violence in the region. But to Islamabad's much amazement and shock, all the attempted terror activities have fallen flat, owing to the alert Indian government and its security forces.
A large number of people get killed in terror attacks every year the world over. In South Asia, the situation is grim as state-sponsored terrorists and agencies are behind the genocide of civilians, be it tribal invasion of 1947 in Jammu and Kashmir, 1971 Bangladesh genocide, or the present army operations ongoing in Balochistan and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Pakistan has its major contribution to create unrest in the Indian subcontinent. Take a look.
Terrorism and unrest is prevalent far and wide in today's modern world, but the situation in South Asia is very depressing. The reason is not hidden. Since it was created in 1947, Pakistan had embraced the ideology of committing atrocities and genocide in the subcontinent. State-sponsored terrorism in the Muslim-majority nation has been a challenge for peaceful existence of Indian subcontinent. Pakistani army and terrorist outfits, which started committing genocide since the 1947 Kashmir invasion, is continuing its brutal doctrine till today. It provides shelter and training to terrorists who infiltrate into Jammu and Kashmir and create unrest and violence.
Terrorism is the karma, you know, you unleash it onto others and it comes back to you. So Pakistan is already experiencing that. There has been a lot of terrorism in Pakistan, you know, attack of schools and, you know, attack against mosques. So I believe that Pakistan eventually will disintegrate because they have unleashed so much violence and terrorism against the world and particularly against India that it will come back to them.
Pakistan was founded on the principle of communal hate, and so its initial target was the Hindus. It used Islamic fundamentalists and terrorists to unleash violence and atrocities on Kashmiri Pandits in 1989. Hundreds of Kashmiri Pandits were killed, and the world chose to remain silent on this brutal ethnic cleansing.
I was a witness to the ethnic cleansing of the Kashmiri Pandits in the Valley of Kashmir, and it opened my eyes. I saw for the first time with my own eyes, firsthand, that a religion can shave another people in the name of their God, and it really shook me.
Islamabad never hesitated to kill its own people. The subcontinent saw biggest genocide after establishment of Pakistan in 1971. Pakistani army killed lakhs of innocent Bengali people just because their language was different and they had their own opinion. Pakistani military raped women, killed children just to show their anger and to prove their superiority. It led to the division of Pakistan and birth of a new nation called Bangladesh.
When I think about the subcontinent, obviously I think about the largest genocide that happened, and that is the Bangladesh genocide done by the Pakistani army and its collaborators. Yet the whole globe seems to have forgotten it. This is, you know, as Gary J. Bass termed in his book, the forgotten genocide. So that hurts me as a victim's daughter.
More than 70 years have passed since the day Pakistan as a country came into existence, but Islamabad is still moving ahead with the same kind of modus operandi. Today, the Baloch, Sindhis and Pashtun who are living in Pakistan are on the target. Killings, torture, rapes and enforced disappearances have become the fate of the people living in Balochistan, Sindh and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa.
Baloch have this form of victimization where they just disappear. They're never found again. It began that way in the mid-1970s. Now you have a new phenomenon, an evolution of that, which is kill and dump. Your body can be found many years later. Sometimes these bodies are identified. Mama Kadir's son was identified. Some bodies are beyond identification and they use DNA when the relatives say, we suspect that this is our brother's.
The country, which has created unrest in South Asia, must pay for its deeds. The Financial Action Task Force has put Pakistan on its grey list and has asked Islamabad to act against terrorists and stop providing financial assistance to them. The world now understands the mischievous acts of Pakistan and holds it responsible for providing hardship to humanity.
Pakistan, which has been for years sponsoring and aiding terror organizations on its soil, has now been forced to kneel down in front of the international community. Following the sham arrest of terror leaders Zakir Rehman Lakhvi and Hafiz Saeed, who plotted and supervised the 26/11 Mumbai terror attack, this week Pakistan's so-called anti-terrorism court indicted three close aides of Hafiz Saeed on terror financing charges. The move seems nothing but just an exercise to hoodwink the international community in order to avoid the wrath of FATF and escape the economic sanctions from various foreign financing institutions and countries allied with Pakistan, a report.
Pakistan, for decades, has been sponsoring and aiding terror organizations on its soil, which are responsible for a large number of terrorist attacks in the entire world, especially India. However, with the huge pressure from the international community building up, Pakistan has been compelled to take actions against these terrorists. In the recent development, an anti-terrorism court in Pakistan indicted three top leaders of Jamaat-ud-Dawah and close aides of the 2008 Mumbai terror attack mastermind Hafiz Saeed in a terror financing case. All three accused were sentenced to 6 months in prison. Saeed's brother-in-law Hafiz Abdul Rahman Makki, Zafar Iqbal, and outfit's media face Yahya Mujahid were handed down the 6 month imprisonment each by the anti-terrorism court Lahore.
This is Pakistan's ploy to hoodwink FATF. They know that the meeting is coming up in February. And in that meeting, they would try their best not to get into blacklist and, if possible, get out of the grey list as well. Now, blacklist they will be able to avoid because they need just three votes to be out of blacklist, which they will get, whether it is China, Turkey and Malaysia. But getting out of grey list, I think that is their effort.
Whenever international pressure builds up, Islamabad comes up with a few announcements of arrests of terrorists operating from its soil. No wonder that Punjab State's counter-terrorism department suddenly woke up to the presence of Zakir Rehman Lakhvi, Lashkar-e-Taiba operations commander and the mastermind of the Mumbai 2611 massacre, who was roaming around freely and ordered his arrest at the beginning of this year. Earlier, Pakistan's so-called anti-terrorism court sentenced Jamaat-ud-Dawah chief Hafiz Saeed for collective imprisonment of 36 years on 5 terror finance charges. And later this month, an arrest warrant against UN-designated global terrorist and Jaish-e-Mohammed's chief Masood Azhar was issued in a terror financing case. However, no arrest has been made so far.
He has been conviction for money laundering and not for Mumbai terror attacks. Same is the case with the other terrorists. The aim is very simple. They make a sham arrest, they make a sham conviction, and with that conviction, they try and give, these are light charges. They are not such grave charges. So with that, they will be able to perhaps appeal to the next court immediately after the FATF meeting is over, and once they have avoided the FATF punishment, then they'll appeal and then they'll get all of them acquitted, and then it will be business as usual.
Even in the most blatant cases, the Pakistani system does not seem interested in punishing the guilty, but acts solely to mislead the international community. The order by the Sindh High Court to release Ahmed Umar Saeed Sheikh and 3 accomplices, all convicted for the murder of American journalist Daniel Pearl, illustrates the apathy of the judicial system. These terror leaders are created and nurtured by the all-powerful Pakistani military. Hence, neither the civilian administration nor the Pakistani judiciary has the guts to override the Rawalpindi elite.
In Pakistan, you will find that the judiciary will initially convict these terrorists, and subsequently the upper court is going to release them. The point is very simple. When it is a duration when the FATF meeting is about to happen, then these convictions will take place, and thereafter they will appeal and they will be released. Judiciary is totally compromised. They are under the influence of Pakistan Army.
However, several reports have claimed that Pakistan, which is in FATF's grey list since 2018, might be pushed into its blacklist next month as it continues to finance and shelter terror organizations. In June 2018, Pakistan was put on the grey list for terror financing. It was given 2 years to clean up its act and 27 action points to deliver. The deadline passed this year. In October 2020, a review was conducted and Pakistan failed. Pakistan was set to be blacklisted, but it did not happen. It was saved again and given another extension. Now it has time till February 2021. This repeated story has also raised questions over FATF's credibility, for it has proven toothless against a terror state.
India and the United Kingdom have always reiterated to strengthen cooperation in taking decisive action against globally proscribed terror groups. In a recently held meeting, both countries strongly condemned terrorism in all its forms and manifestations. The two sides emphasized on the need for strengthening international cooperation to combat the global menace of terrorism comprehensively, including cross-border terrorism in South Asia. Our report.
Terrorism is posing a serious threat to global peace and harmony. Even nation now pledges to fight back terrorism and oppose those who provide shelter to these extremists. India and United Kingdom join hands under the India-United Kingdom Joint Working Group to discuss counter-terrorism strategy. At a two-day virtual meeting, the two sides reviewed the threats posed by UN-proscribed terrorists and terrorist entities and exchanged views on the proscription of terrorist individuals and entities as a tool to combat terrorism. The two countries exchange ideas for further strengthening bilateral cooperation in the sphere of counter-terrorism, including counter-radicalization and violent extremism, combating the financing of terrorism, and preventing exploitation of internet for terrorism. India and UK also discussed counter-terrorism cooperation in multilateral fora such as United Nations and Financial Action Task Force.
A consultative meetings should not only be limited to this working group, but on a regular basis and a real-time basis, information should be shared, which includes the all hideouts of the terrorists in Pakistan, their training centers, and also the, what all information that India has gathered should be shared with UK so that a joint operation, whenever required, can be done.
Both India and the UK have suffered several terrorist attacks in the recent past. Just 2 months ago, the UK's terrorism threat level was upgraded from substantial to severe. Although the action was a precautionary measure following terror attacks in Europe, London continues to face potential threats from jihadis and the countries which are breeding grounds for anti-West ideology. Recently, a report released by the UK Treasury Department called the National Risk Assessment of Money Laundering and Terror Financing 2020 illustrated how the United Kingdom has become a hub for Pakistan's dirty money and how criminals and terrorists exploit the loopholes in the British financial system. The British report said Pakistani criminals are using the routes to buy high-value assets like real estate, precious gems and jewellery to launder money.
Problem here lies is that terrorists and especially Pakistan ISI is one organization which has exploited all loopholes in all countries, whether it is UK, whether it is European countries, even the United States of America, because America, you remember, there was this Ghulam Ahmad Fai, who was then convicted after FBI carried out investigations that this man was an ISI agent. What Britishers in the UK have to do is share information of all these accounts with India, and India should share accounts, the information with the UK authorities, because India also has a long list of all these accounts and all these way that the money is being moved.
The West is increasingly concerned about dreaded terror organizations based in Pakistan and Afghanistan. They include Al-Qaeda, Lashkar-e-Taiba, Hizbul Mujahideen and the Taliban. Dreaded terrorists who have committed heinous crimes and attacks run freely in Pakistan. Those who were put behind the bars even get released without conviction. Ahmed Omar Shahid Sheikh, who was convicted of killing US journalist Daniel Pearl, was released by Pakistan's Supreme Court. Sheikh, a 47-year-old British Pakistani, was the main suspect in the 2002 kidnapping and murder of Pearl, a Wall Street Journal reporter. The court also dismissed an appeal of Sheikh's acquittal by Pearl's family. There are tens and hundreds of such terrorists in Pakistan who freely run their terror factories without any fear.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Savage signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.